You're watching the 2018 Legatus Summit.
And that's a really great practice as we are going to be welcoming our next speaker. Dr. Paul Voss is a renowned leadership speaker and executive coach, president of Ethicos, and his topic today is the Catholic work ethic. He needs to write one for parish priests as well, all right? Dr. Paul Voss's esteemed work through Ethicos is specializing in executive leadership, culture, coaching, corporate stewardship, and public service, receiving high evaluations from major industries across the country, things that you know like FedEx and Home Depot, Cox Communications. And as an associate professor of Georgia State University, he is an award-winning teacher of Shakespeare, Dante. So you're gonna get ready for a little bit of drama here, all right? Business ethics, Renaissance literature, and the history of the book. His proven leadership skills and approach builds on a 25,000 year of intellectual history, thought, and human behavior. He's married, thank God, to his wife, Mary, living in suburban Atlanta with their 5 children. And he's very proud to say, a son of the U.S. Naval Academy and now a second lieutenant for the United States Marine Corps. And he's asking for your prayers as prayers for his son, as well as all of those people, because his son's going to be deployed very soon. And so we thank him not only for being a great dad, but also for giving us a new understanding of a saint that many of you are going to be invoking. His forthcoming book is on the biography of Saint Omobonos, who is the patron of business leaders and entrepreneurs. So here to tell us more about him and his work, let's give Dr. Paul Voss a warm welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here. And 2 weeks ago, I was up in Louisville, Kentucky, and I think the slide deck will be coming up momentarily. Do I have to? Oh, I couldn't see it where I am. Sorry about that. 2 weeks ago, I was in Louisville, Kentucky. Thank you for the Louisville chapter for hosting me. And thank you very much. But it was the second time I was in Louisville this year. In June of 2017, I went to Louisville to talk to a bunch of accountants, 200, 300 accountants, and they put me up at the Brown Hotel. I don't know if any of you have been to the Brown Hotel. It opened in 1923. It's a beautiful hotel. It's very elegant. A list of famous guests. Presidents have stayed there. It's kind of a throwback hotel. And I started researching this guy named James Graham Brown. There's a picture of him. And he was an eccentric little guy. He was a philanthropist. He was legendary in his frugality. He was a benefactor to many causes throughout all of Louisville. And he was involved in Churchill Downs. He never married. He lived in the hotel his whole life with his little dog. And as I was walking around the hotel, there was a little display case with the artifacts of his life. And in his handwritten notes, he had a document called the Cardinal Rules for Success in Business. The cardinal rules, cardinal, right? The hinge, it's Latin for cardinus. The hinge, the most important things he could pass on to other business leaders to guarantee their success. So I went over there and I read it. And I was stunned, but not shocked by what I saw. Because here are his cardinal rules. He said, devote all of your time, day and night, to your business. Never once stop conducting the business. He said, never get married. He said, never take a vacation. Never have hobbies or sidelines. Don't have partners. And kind of in a funny way, he said, never borrow a small amount of money. If you're going to borrow money, borrow a large amount of money. So the bank has to keep you open because the bank can't lose that money. Now, I looked at this as a Catholic and I said, this is so foreign to my understanding of business, the purpose and the meaning of business. But as I said, I identified it immediately because I identified it as something that the famous sociologist Max Weber called the Protestant work ethic or the Puritan work ethic. You see, the Puritan work ethic was a thesis of Max Weber from 1904, and it basically said that America, the greatness of America, can be traced to the confluence of free market, free enterprise, free economy, and the individualization of Protestantism. And he said that the fear of idleness, the fear of sloth, created in these people a drive, a drive to accumulate, a drive to build. And we know some of these folks as the industrialists. Some people call them the robber barons. If you look at the litany of people on this list, and it is the Carnegies and the Rockefellers and the Morgans and the Huntingtons, all of these people had something in common. They were all steeped in the Protestant tradition. Many of them were Scots-Irish. They worked really, really hard. They were men of sobriety and most often of the Baptist faith. And they believed that material wealth was the reward and blessing of God's beneficence on their activities. They believed that they were doing the Lord's work in the accumulation, the massive accumulation of wealth. Now, again, this is a very foreign concept to people who grew up in a Catholic community or a Catholic country, because if you go to Rome even today, from 1 to 3 o'clock, everything's shut down so people can take their nap. Of course you take your nap, right? In France, they've mandated a 36-hour work week. In Spain, they take the entire month of August off, for example. Go to Latin America, you will see a very different conception of work. And from a Western perspective, we sometimes say, well, they don't have the strong work ethic. They need to work harder. So what I'd like to do today is I'd like to propose a Catholic work ethic, because here's what the research says. Harvard Business Review, June 2017. 70% of Americans at some time, 70% of Americans at some time who work, get stuck in a rut. They get stuck in a rut usually after 30 years of working. They get stuck in a rut with their work, with their career, with their marriage, with their prayer life, with their diet. If you ever wonder what stuck in a rut is, that's stuck in a rut, right? That's a rut, and there's a bicycle, and he's stuck in a rut. But it's not uncommon, but there's more demographics that are shocking, according to the CDC. The only demographic in the United States, where life expectancy is going down, white males 45 to 55. White males 45 to 55 are losing ground. More suicides, more drug addictions, more people dropping. The level of happiness in most workers in America is going down. It's really kind of stunning, but this kind of comes as a surprise, even though I read On Walden Pond by Henry David Thoreau. You probably remember On Walden Pond. Remember, Henry David Thoreau wanted to live a life deliberately. He wanted to go back into the woods so he could feel real, he could be real. And he said, I am going to separate myself from civil society in order to really expose myself to God the Creator. Now, this is before I found out that he was a phony. You realize he only moved a mile away from mommy. She still did his laundry on weekends, this sort of thing. But when I read his book at 17, he had a phrase in there that haunted me. And that phrase was, the mass of men live lives of quiet desperation. Now, if that's true, that means the majority of human beings are quietly living lives without hope. It's like Dante at the beginning of hell, abandon hope, all you who enter here. And I said, that can't be true. When I was 17, I didn't think it was true because people were out and they were at restaurants and they were in ball games. And in 2018, I said, that can't be true. We're abundantly blessed and the planes are full and the restaurants are full and the baseball games are full. So I said, what does the data say? What does the data say? According to the most recent survey, Gallup poll 2013, they asked 10,110 Americans, do you like your job? 10,110 Americans. 70% of Americans said they either hate their job or they're actively disengaged. They either hate their job or they're actively disengaged. You know what that sounds like to me? It sounds like the mass of men are living lives of quiet desperation. And how can you tell if you're the president or the CEO or the COO of a company if people are actively disengaged? Well, there's a quick litmus test. If you go to your workplace in the morning, there's a piece of rubbish on the ground, an actively engaged employee will stop, pick up that rubbish, and throw it away. A disengaged employee will see that rubbish, step right over that rubbish, and continue on to work. Someone who actively hates their job, threw that rubbish there in the first place. So if you've got 70% of your people who are actively disengaged, you're at a competitive disadvantage. You are at a competitive disadvantage because an engaged workforce, a Chick-fil-A workforce, someone who says my pleasure and someone who's going to make sure you have a clean bathroom is going to be a stronger, more productive, more healthy workforce. So what's my point? My point is that the way we increase engagement at work is the same way we increase engagement at home. The number one thing a person can do to increase employee engagement isn't to throw money at the problem. Believe it or not, the most important thing a person can do to increase engagement is to give an attaboy or an attagirl. The most important thing you can do is to write a handwritten note to somebody who's helped you, or to send flowers to the spouse of somebody who's done overtime, to show your gratitude. A $50 gift card might work on a minimum wage employee. $50 gift card doesn't really work to motivate and to engage the same way that a handwritten note does. So what am I talking about? I'm talking about creating a theology of work, a Catholic work ethic, an ethic that juxtaposes itself with the Protestant work ethic. Now, we don't really have one. We don't really have a Catholic work ethic. But if we have one, it's probably best articulated by Joseph Pieper in this book, Leisure as the Basis of Culture. Because the Catholic work ethic says that the reason for us to work, there's only one reason for us to work, and work is a good thing. Adam and Eve worked in the Garden of Eden. The only reason we ought to work is so we can secure leisure time. Because in leisure time we can pray and we can love and we can paint and we can read and we contemplate. So Joseph Pieper juxtaposes the active life, negotium, with the contemplative life, otium. Negotium is that Latin word where we get negotiate. It's a really important word. But if we just give over to negotiation our entire life and we don't have time for otium, a reflection, a moment where we can think and ponder. There's a reason why the church gives us feast days. Sure, we have 52 days off a year on a Sunday, but the church also gives us feast days, an opportunity to celebrate and to rejoice. Otium is not sloth. It's not idleness. Otium is the philosophical act that asks us to contemplate the existence of our business, not work in our business, but to work on our business. And the Catholic social teaching has always talked about the dignity of work. We've heard about some of the documents this weekend, but I believe absolutely that work does two things. Of course, work enables. Work enables us to live. It enables us to make payments. It enables us to have tuition for our children. And those of you who own businesses, God bless you. Small business is the engine that drives this country. You provide salaries for hundreds of people who then go out and make lives for themselves. Of course, work enables. It enables us to function. But quality work does something more than that. Quality work ennobles us. It makes us better. Because all work has been pre-sanctified. Why? Because Jesus worked in a carpenter shop with his dad. And he has already pre-sanctified work. So if we are working, and we're working to the best of our ability, we are already participating in the sanctification of work. Now, it can get carried away and it can become workaholism. That's why the church gives us patron saints. Some of you know, and I've been to a number of your chapters, some of you know already about my work on St. Omo Bono. The translation is done. St. Omo Bono has been almost universally ignored in the English-speaking world, even though he's an important saint. You see, in 1199, Innocent III named St. Omo Bono patron of merchants and entrepreneurs in 1199. It's over 800 years ago, and his story has never been told in English. You see, he was so powerful and so wonderfully revered that at his funeral, hundreds and thousands of people showed up because he had given his life. He had given his life to a life of service. And even today in Cremona, Italy, they still venerate St. Omo Bono. His incorrupt body is below the high church altar in the cathedral there. But Omo Bono, the church, in their wisdom in 1199 said, the world is changing. The traditional forms of work, agriculture, are being replaced by a new merchant class. We need models of heroic behavior that are going to provide us some kind of stimulation and some kind of idea of how to navigate the complexities of this world. And in 1199, the very first thing that the canon, the bull of canonization. He's the only lay person in the entire medieval period to be canonized. Think about that. He was the only lay person who walked like we walked, who worked like we worked, to be canonized in the medieval period. The very first document, the very first line of the very first document talks about the Protestant work ethic. It said, it is difficult for one who practices business to divest himself of religious indifference. It's really, really hard, this document said, for successful business leaders to disinvest themselves from their business and to pursue religion. They say it's almost impossible to cultivate a meaningful faith life and a meaningful business life. But because of his daily prayers, because of his sanctification and his piety, he was, quote, saved from the perverse and miserable practices of the market. I could go on about this guy, but one thing they said is that business was a grindstone, that it kept grinding him down until one day at age 50, he had an epiphany. And, quote, his formerly calloused preoccupation with increasing his wealth began to cool. He said, clearly, there must be something more than the accumulation of wealth. Clearly, there must be something more than just the mere accumulation of wealth. And he strove to try and find it. And what he did is he struck a deal with his wife. All of the proceeds he made from his vineyard, his entrepreneurial activities, went to charity and to those less fortunate than him. But let's ask you a question. What if you find yourself stuck in a rut? What if you find yourself currently kind of stuck in a rut? There's nothing to be ashamed of. There are reasons for it. As men and women age, we tend to gain weight. We tend to stop producing testosterone or estrogen. We get into a routine. Food might not taste quite as good. The bodies of our life, the cars of our life, have suffered a few dings and dents. You accumulate a few things along the way. Well, Joseph Pieper gives us five things that we can do as Catholics, five awakenings that will help us as we progress through the kind of common everyday life, five things that we can remind ourselves as Catholics to help us get unstuck from that rut. The first of them, he said, is philosophy. What a beautiful word. Philia Sophia. The love of wisdom. Philosophy can be defined as reason unaided by revelation. There's a certain inherent joy in finding things out. What do you read? Are you being challenged in your reading? Do you have different materials that you can read, whether it's First Things or even the Magnificat or the Catechism or just books in general? What are you doing to try and become philosophical and engage in reflection and thinking? But you cannot engage in the philosophical act without the odium, without some kind of leisure. 89% of Americans, the first thing they touch in the morning and the last thing they touch at night is their cell phone. Study after study after study is showing the damaging effect on young people and on baby boomers of being addicted to that technology, to be continually plugged in 100% of the day, never being able to remove yourself from the entanglement of that phone. If you're continually connected, you are not going to be able to engage in philosophy. The second awakening that as Catholics we need to be aware of is love. The emptying of oneself, the freely giving and humbleness of love. But in America, I guess in English, that word has so many meanings. Love, love, love. I love my wife. I love my children. I love God. But yes, I love pizza. I love afternoon naps. I love cupcakes last night, right? And once you start using that word over and over and over, it loses a little of its uniqueness. It loses a little of its texture. And so, of course, C.S. Lewis, a book that I, if you haven't read, I would recommend. You could polish it off in a night or two. The Four Loves, because the Greek language has four different distinct words for that word that we use as love. The first love is affection, fondness, the love that you might have of a favorite pair of jeans or your favorite Chinese restaurant. In fact, affection is probably responsible for 9/10 of the durable happiness that we feel each and every day as human beings. In fact, one sign of depression is when you can no longer feel a fondness for the little things of life. Are you still able to enjoy the fondness of little things in life? My wife recently went to a Garth Brooks concert. It was the first concert that was in Atlanta's Mercedes-Benz Stadium. And she goes, honey, do you care much if I don't take you? I said, honey, I'll give you $100 if I don't have to go. Because, listen, she's very fond of Garth Brooks, and her fondness makes me happy. I'm glad that she has a fondness for it, but I don't have to enjoy all of the things that she enjoys the same way. I try and cultivate them. C.S. Lewis says a dog might be fond of a cat. He's just not going to tell all the other dogs that he's fond of the cat. Another thing that happens to men, especially men, I don't know if it happens to women as well, is as we get older, we have fewer and fewer friendships. Male friendships are an interesting thing. Male friendships are formed in rites of passage, through battle, through the Marines, through the football teams, through starting a business. And as we get older, we tend to have fewer and fewer friendships. But cultivating a friendship, having a genuine friend, not a business associate, but a genuine friend, the philia of life, really, really important. Don't have to tell you about the importance of the third category, but I also don't have to tell you that after 25 or 30 years or 35 or 40 years of marriage, we might take that for granted, or it might not continue to be the source of pleasure that it used to be. What are we doing to try and cultivate that, to reanimate that? Are we doing anything in our lives to really try and reach out to that person that we've been with for such a long time and enjoy wonderful nights out? That's why I know they say that Legatus is Catholic date night. What a beautiful thing, right? To once a month be able to go and get dressed up a little bit and to go and have a nice mass and the Eucharist and then go out and hear a speaker and have dinner, come to the summit every year. Beautiful. Then those are all natural loves, by the way, C.S. Lewis says. Those are the three natural loves. But then the fourth love is unnatural. The fourth love is called agape in Greek, or caritas in Latin, or charity. Charity is not natural. It makes sense when we support our team, our family, our tribe. It doesn't make sense evolutionarily why we would give money to Haiti earthquake relief, right? It makes no sense to us why we would give our resources to people that we don't know. There's nothing in it for us. But the first century Romans who were killing the Christians, and you know this story, they were writing letters back to Rome, and they say, these Christians are kind of weird people. These Christians are strange because, first of all, they're monotheists. They won't believe in all of our gods. But more strange than that is that these Christians, well, they love one another. They love people who aren't part of their tribe. In a strange way, they had never seen that kind of love before. They had never seen that kind of agape. In fact, the Greek word agape made its first appearance in the Greek language about 2,000 years ago. At about the same time when a baby was born in Bethlehem, Aristotle and Plato have no understanding of agape. It's a uniquely Christian kind of love. And it reminds us, people, that there's no virtue in loving a sleeping baby. There is no virtue in loving a sleeping baby. Loving a sleeping baby is easy. We love it when we get our children sleeping. The virtue is in loving a crying baby, a baby who's hungry or teething or needs its diaper changed. There's no virtue in loving a beautiful, kind, compassionate, faithful spouse. The virtue comes, thank you, Mary, for loving me even when I'm flawed, even when I'm not living up to my expectations, and even when I forget to put my things away. The virtue of loving your employees is easy when they are productive and they're hardworking and they're bringing revenue. It becomes a little more difficult when they are probably not working up to their expectations. So love is the second awakening. Love is the second awakening that Pieper talks about. The third becomes really important. I was talking to some friends from the Vancouver chapter last night, and whether she realizes or not, she made this point. She said, you know what, one of the advantages of being Catholic is even when you are spiritually dry. I mean, there are moments when prayers just come forth. There are moments when you're just so grateful and on top of the world, and the spontaneous forms of prayer just spring forth without much beckoning. But there are other times when you might have a little bit of a spiritual dryness, where the prayers aren't as easily forthcoming. And that's why the wisdom of the church has given us set forms of prayer, the Our Father and the Hail Mary, because even in our state of spiritual dryness, we can still utter those words that are faithful and that graces will continue to come. See, when we moved to Atlanta 25 years ago, I was always surprised at how willingly the Baptists would get up and give a spontaneous prayer before a meeting or at lunch. And I was initially really impressed by their public speaking skills until I realized that it's a spontaneous prayer. Yeah, but they're all the same. I mean, you listen to the spontaneous prayer, it's all thank you, Jesus, for every. I mean, there's a certain kind of regularity to that spontaneous form of prayer. Luckily, we have both. We can have the Holy Spirit fill the heart of our faithful and set the world on fire, but we can also have some kind of prayer and meditation and reflection. Prayer is one of those things, though, kind of like exercising, that we sometimes cast aside. And it's a habit like anything else. Once you get in the habit of doing something, it becomes habitual. A morning offering, an angelus, examination of conscience. Something that you can do as a friend, as a family, pray together with and for each other. And this prayer enhances an awakening of love in the world. The fourth one happens naturally as well, and it happens with a greater amount of frequency as you age. I'm of the age now where every 2 months, someone in my life that I love passes away. My dad's one of 13, my mom's one of 5, my father-in-law recently passed, my mentor recently passed. Nothing focuses life quite like death. The Elizabethans used the phrase memento mori, a remembrance of death. My wife and I were recently in London, and I contacted the warder of the Tower of London, and I asked if I could have permission to go and see the cell where Thomas More, my patron saint, was held for 14 months. Could I go and visit the crypt where his tomb is, because it's not available to the public? And surprisingly, I received an email granting me permission. They gave my wife and I a beefeater. We were able to go and spend an hour down in Thomas More's cell, seeing where he lived, touching the bricks, breathing in that cold December air. And then we got to go over to the crypt and see where Thomas More was buried and say a prayer. And it gave me fortitude and resolution. Thank you, Thomas More, patron saint of so many causes. We have to remember to pray like everything depends on God, but live as everything depends on us. And those moments in our life where we experience death of a loved one should understand and help us inculcate gratitude and a resolution to make sure that we're going to move forward. The oldest statement in the world that you hear is, nobody says they wish their tombstone said, I only have one regret in life, that I didn't spend more time at my office. When you read about the people who have died and you've experienced those deaths in your life, that is one of the awakenings. But perhaps the maybe the most consequential awakening, and the awakening that could be the world needs the most, perhaps, is simply beauty. Because I've dedicated my life to the study of beauty. I teach Shakespeare. I teach Dante. I'm in the liberal arts and the humanities. And here's what I know, that young people today are drawn to beauty. They don't even know how to explain it. They are drawn to it like the moth to the flame. They are so conversant with death and destruction and ugliness and sin, but they have no vocabulary, no conception of how beauty works in the world. And listen, the Catholic Church owns beauty. Do you realize that? If you take the Catholic Church out of the world, what other source of beauty is there? Who is the repository of the beautiful and the true and the good? Where do you have the museums and the churches still dedicated to a sense of the divine? Inculcating beauty in your life can happen in a lot of ways, and some of them very modest. And some of you might have heard this story as well, but about 5 or 6 years ago, with the 5 kids and the football and the track and the soccer, we kind of got a crazy life going, and we got into a bad habit at home. We got into a habit of eating while we were standing up. And what happened is we have this big island in our kitchen, and Mary or I would bring in the food one by one. The potatoes would come in, the steak would come in, the pizzas would come in. And the kids would just start grazing, and we'd all start grazing, and we were eating standing up, and we did it for about a week and a half. And finally I said, this is crazy. If we are going to eat, we are going to do it properly. Every night the table will be set. We will have regular china. I very rarely lay down the law at home, and I said, but here's what we're going to do. We're going to have a candle on the table every single night. We're going to have a candle on the table every single night to signify the Holy Spirit. And we're going to have background music, Mozart or Bach or Beethoven or Gregorian chant, something in the background. And all of a sudden, the conversation elevates. All of a sudden, we now have a common vocabulary and a purpose. And if someone starts talking something inappropriate, say, hey, let's elevate the language tonight. We're at the dinner table. I remember my dad saying that all the time. And it always kind of irritated me when I was a high school student. I'm saying that now. Hey, we're at the dinner table. Can we postpone that discussion? This is family time. I remember about 6 months ago, I was sitting there and it got a little dark out and I had the candle. And the candle's kind of funny because our pastor was complaining of how expensive the Easter candles were. And he had to keep going and buy one. I said to Padre, how much are Easter candles? And he goes, well, they're very expensive. I go, tell me how much Easter candles are. He told me, I'll buy the Easter candle under one condition. You give me the last little nub of the Easter candle. So I took that home, and every night we light the Easter candle on our table, and that's the Easter candle that has seen all the baptisms and all the weddings and all the confirmations in our parish. And so each year he now hits me up regularly. Hey, you got the money for the Easter candle? I go, Padre, it's February. You need the money right now? Come on. I mean, this sort of thing. But the light was getting a little low, and the candle was there, and I looked up, and I saw my wife sitting there, and I kind of caught my breath. And she goes, what's wrong? And I was embarrassed to tell her. I said, gosh, I just got a view of you and reminded me so painfully clearly why I fell in love with you. I caught the look of you that I remembered 25 years ago. And because of that candle and because of that beauty, it kind of took my breath away. So what are we doing to inculcate beauty in our life? Little things that can separate us from the meanness of the world. Because Flannery O'Connor, that great Georgian writer, the wonderful, wonderful Flannery O'Connor, once said about the Eucharist, she says, if it's just a symbol, I'd say to hell with it. I paraphrase that. If our faith is just a symbol, I'd say to hell with it. If it doesn't really have a purchase on our life, if it doesn't change who we are as husbands and wives, as business partners, as friends, as neighbors, then what good is it? But the beautiful thing about the faith is it gives us five awakenings, five really easy things to see and to identify and embrace in life. And so just for the last minute, I'd like to ask you a question. How do you cultivate a Catholic work ethic? What are you doing to make sure that you're cultivating a Catholic work ethic? And that way, by the way, it still means working hard. I love hard work. My father used to say over and over, success comes before work only in the dictionary. Only in the dictionary does success come before work. But what are you doing to cultivate that work-life balance? What are you doing to help others in that pursuit? Do you personally feel in some way, shape, or form stuck in a rut? And if so, which awakening can help you manage that challenge? And if you take one of those awakenings and it unsticks you even for a week or even for a month, then I'd say that's time well spent. Thank you very much. God bless you all. Appreciate the opportunity.
Please join us for the 2019 Summit at the Monarch Beach Resort in Dana Point, California, January 24th through the 26th, 2019.